When we think about the Rolling Stones in the United States, one of the first thing that that strikes us as we look back at the chart numbers and all of that is that the Rolling Stones had a much harder time getting themselves established in the United States than the Beatles did. When we tell the Beatles story, it's all about the Ed Sullivan Show, February 9th, 1964. You know, instant acclaim. All of a sudden, they've got tons of records on the charts at the same time. At one point, they were occupying the first five chart position on the singles chart. I mean, just massive success, so not just in the United States, worldwide. The Stones, not so much at first. They would come around and tour, and they'd get pretty good crowds in New York and Los Angeles and in the big cities, but as they went across the heartland of the U.S., sometimes they were playing state fairs, and there weren't many folks there. They had to work harder at it. They ended up having a tremendous sustained success once they got it and continued to be able to play wherever they want to in the world and sell out stadiums, but it came a little bit more slowly for the Rolling Stones. One of the interesting things Andrew Lou Oldham, their manager, devised from the very beginning was to juxtapose the Stones against the Beatles. The Stones would be the bad boys because the Beatles had already sort of taken up the space of good boys. I mean, the Beatles were charming, they were bright, they were witty and charismatic, and the kind of young man that maybe the parents of young women in America wouldn't be so unhappy if their daughters got involved with. The Rolling Stones, however, were the kind of guys that you didn't want your daughter ever to get involved in. Who knows what's going on with the smoking and the drinking and the sloppy appearance and all this kind of thing. They looked sexually menacing. They were definitely the bad guys. And what's interesting in the popular music business is you'll see this kind of market positioning happening over and over again. We can already go back to the 50s and see Pat Boone as the good boy and Elvis as the bad boy back in that period around 1956, 1957, into 1958. In fact, one of the reasons we said that Elvis went into the army was to kind of correct that bad boy image so he could be a little bit more mainstream. By 1960, 61, 62, 63, and all those movies I talked about, he was just as good boy can get. So here, along come the Stones, they're the bad boys. The Beatles are the good boys. Their success, as I said, was not immediate, but the big hit for them was I Can't Get No Satisfaction, number one in the UK, number one in the US in 1965. It made them stars, and there was a story that arose about the lyrics that said they had to do with a certain amount of sexual frustration, let's say. I Can't Get No Satisfaction. And when asked about that, the song is about not being able to get satisfaction in all kinds of areas of life, but there is one line that could be seen as having to do with sexuality. And when this became a big story, remember, it wasn't too long ago, maybe in 1963, 1964, that everybody was all worked up about the possibility there could be a swear word in Louie Louie. I mean, to the extent that, you know, the FBI were brought in to listen to the tapes with all their scientifically advanced technology to see whether or not they'd actually used a bad word, the FBI determined that they couldn't tell. But nevertheless, that was the kind of thing, you know, a single bad word, a single reference could get a song off the playlist. But what the Rolling Stones decided to do was to not deny the reference to sexual frustration in the song. It reinforced their bad boy image, but there was nothing in it that was so blatant that it would get the record canceled. And of course, it was a fantastic promotional thing for them and really sort of cemented their image of being the kind of ne'er-do-wells of the British invasion. Other hits that we can point to from this period, 65 and 66, Get Off of My Cloud, which was number one in both countries in 65, and Paint It Black, which was number one in both countries in 1966, in addition to a number of other hits that did very well too. Sometimes Stones fans don't like to hear this, and you may have a different opinion about it, but my opinion is that for most of the 1960s, the Stones remained in some ways in the shadow of the Beatles. They were kind of, in the early days, 63, 64, always the junior partners to the Beatles. The Beatles' success always overshadowed the success of the Stones, and many times you can see the Stones seeming to imitate things that the Beatles had done just before that. And it really isn't until the Beatles are on the ropes and getting ready to break up in 1969, after the release of Abbey Road, that the Stones, almost it's like they have a burden lifted from them when the Beatles are no longer together again. And it's really in the early 70s that they really start to blossom and come into their own as 70s rock and rollers. So if you think about some of those tunes and Sticky Fingers, albums like that. That's really where the Stones really start to become the Stones. In many ways, we look back at the success of the Stones, and maybe because they became so much bigger later, we may be sometimes guilty of exaggerating their stature. They were big, but the Beatles were probably almost always bigger. Again, that's more a matter of opinion interpretation, so there won't be any questions about that on the quiz. Let's go forward now and talk about other British bands from the British Invasion and how they sounded.